Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
So let's get into this. Last week we were reminded that every time we mess up, God has already hit the delete button. Titus 3 verse 5 says, God saved us not because we were good enough to be saved, but because of his kindness and his grace by washing away our sins, all because of what Jesus Christ our Savior did so that he could declare us good in God's eyes. I said last week that I was planning to move on this week to consequence. God had another idea. So I dare not say that we're going to be moving on to consequence next week because it might not happen. But I did think that God's idea of talking about grace this week was a better idea than mine, which was to talk about consequence. But we can't put the consequences off forever. We will have to talk about them at some point, and I will try and make them as palatable as I can. But, you know, because there are consequences to every decision that we make, good and bad. And the quicker we realize that the consequences that take place in our life, most of which because of our decisions are controllable, some of which that are not, we do need to understand that even though there is this amazing thing called grace, and it is amazing, it wasn't just a cutesy song that someone came up with, it was a real sense of putting into words the fact that this is amazing grace. But the reason that God doesn't want us to keep messing up in our lives, you know, some people can go from beginning to end and mess up, you know, so badly from beginning to end and never learn any lessons. And it's like God's looking down on that person and going, why would you want to do that? Because the consequences are going to cause pain. And I don't want you to keep going through the pain of consequence, because consequence can also carry a sense of condemnation. And you know, like Paul said, there is no condemnation. The problem is if we keep committing the crime and we keep, you know, basically having consequences happen in our lives that produce pain, there's going to be a sense of feeling condemnation more and more and more. So if we want to really understand what it means to not experience condemnation, we've got to do everything we can to not bring about consequence. Everybody with me? So it's really about accepting the grace of God. Watch this.
Grace is God's unmerited favor for us, his crazy love. And the truth is, many times we struggle understanding it. If you find yourself struggling to understand God's grace, don't beat yourself up. Even the disciples struggled with understanding grace.
Jesus, is that you? You're alive. I can't believe you're alive. Okay, I was in the boat and I wasn't catching any fish, okay? But I heard this voice and the voice said, cast your net to the other side. And so I'm thinking, I'm a fisherman. I know what I'm doing, but I'm not catching any fish, you know? And so I throw that net over there and then a gaggle of fish pop into that net and I'm going, this is a total miracle. Who could have done that? I need to know who told me to throw the net to the other side. And boom, I look up and I mean, there is you. You're looking at me on the seashore going, it is I, the Lord, and you're alive. I can't believe you're alive. This is awesome. Andrew, get out of the boat. Come on.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
Yes, I love you. I love you. You're alive. This is so great.
Good. Then feed my sheep.
Andrew, get out of the boat. Come on, man. It's him.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
I love you. Yes. And I'm so sorry about that rooster clucking. I had no idea what that meant, but I do not. I'm better for it. All right. Okay.
Then feed my sheep.
Andrew, I'm smiling, but I'm serious. Come on, get out of the boat. It's him.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
Jesus, mere words cannot describe the passion that I have for you. I love you. You know everything. I love you.
Good. Good. Then feed my sheep.
I didn't even know you had livestock. that is so like you, though. There's something new about you all the time. That's what I love about you.
Peter,
yeah.
Do you remember the morning the ladies went to the tomb?
Yeah. We're all in the upper room trying to figure out what to do next, you know, because we thought you were dead. You know, you were dead, you know, and we're trying to figure all that out, you know. And Mary comes running up, and Mary's like saying, beehive, beehive, beehive. And I'm thinking, I'm allergic to bees. Like, keep them out. You know what I'm saying? But as she kept getting closer, I heard her correctly. She was saying, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive. And we're going, who's alive, who's alive? And she said, she was at the tomb, and the tomb was empty, and she said that there was an angel there, and the angel said, go tell the disciples and Peter that everything is okay, he is risen. And so me and John, we hightailed it down there, and if John says he beat me, he's totally lying, all right? I beat him, FYI, all right, you know? And we get down there, and I'm looking in that tomb, and it is empty. There's nothing in there, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, what does this mean? What does this mean? And John is right there. John is so good with words. He should write a book. He is so good with words. And John said, don't you get it, Peter? This is everything Jesus said he was going to do, and you did it, and it's done. Let's go. This is so great.
Wait, the angel said what?
Go tell the disciples and Peter that everything is okay. He is risen. You've risen. Let's go. This
he
is.
He said what?
Go tell the disciples and Peter. Go tell the disciples and Peter. You said my name. Why did you say my name?
Peter, that's grace.
No, I don't deserve that, because that night people kept coming up to me asking me if I belonged to you, if I was with you, and I kept denying you left and right, all right? No, it'll take me my whole life to make up for what I did. It was unforgivable for what I did.
No. What I did on the cross was meant to take what is unforgivable and make it forgivable. That's my grace. It's not about you. It's always about me. That's grace, Peter.
We'll never understand it, but we do need to accept it. Grace is based on what he's done, not what we did or even what we'll do. He doesn't love us less the more we do, and he doesn't love us more the less we do. He just loves us anyway. Full stop. Sometimes we, like Peter, just need to stop talking. When we bring Gemma up, she had a zippy bear, and we just go zip when we needed her to stop talking. Because she, like Peter, would talk 10 to the dozen. Sometimes we just need to listen. I didn't say she's still like that. I didn't say that. Isaiah 43, verse 25. I want to say it again because I'm not sure that we really got the whole sense of what God was really trying to say last week. I alone, it's God speaking, will blot out your sins for my own sake and will never think of them again. Do we truly get that? There's so much in there. There's so much I could preach on in there that I don't have time to preach on today. But one of the things I want to bring out, because like every couple of words, there's a message. Whatever angle we take this from, there's something that God is trying to say. But one of the things I want to say right up front, and we'll come back to it again, is for his sake, I will blot out your sins for my own sake. Why does he make a point of saying that? Because exactly what that video was saying, where the guy was depicting Jesus, and he said, it's all about me, not about you. We think grace is all about us. But God's saying, no, it's about me. It's about my sake. We go 10 to the dozen, don't we, so often? When we made a big mess in our lives, we want to explain our position, justify our behavior, admit our failure, and we think, you know, if we say more words, we kind of speak 10 to the dozen. And in the process, we miss what God is trying to say to us because of what we're trying to tell him. What's he trying to tell you today? Maybe even right now as I'm speaking, you've got voices going on in your head. You're not going mad. It's just normal. But there are voices saying this message doesn't apply to you today. And somehow those kind of voices get amplified. Because the enemy loves to amplify negative signal. And the enemy's saying things in your mind right now while God's trying to say something positive. And because you're looking from the viewpoint of what you've done, you can't hear his viewpoint from what he did. I want to just say again that we can spend all our lives trying to justify our behavior, justify our position, try and explain ourselves away, and to be honest, it won't make a scrap of difference. Because we can't say enough to actually make a difference. I know what you're thinking. Well, should we therefore not confess our sin? No, the Bible's very clear. We should confess our sin. But listen to what it says. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Now, does he only forgive us our sin when we confess our sin? No, I don't believe so. Otherwise, that would mean it's all dependent on us. And he's already done it. He's already got there. He got there before you. He's already answered your prayer. He's already dealt with your sin. What is it then? It's just us confessing, because confession is good for the soul. God does love to hear us saying we're sorry. But it doesn't make a scrap of difference in terms of the fact that he has already forgiven us. Listen up. God saved us because of his kindness and grace for his sake. For his sake. He saved us because of his kindness and grace for his sake. And I want to say this, and I want to make it personal. So whereas I would normally say us, I'm going to say you. He loves you. He would have sent Jesus to die just for you. If you'd have been the only person he needed to send Jesus for, he would have still done it. Because it's not about numbers. Now, I know what you're thinking, because I've gone through this scenario so many times. No, Pastor, you don't understand. He can't possibly love me that much. You don't know what I've done. And I've got to do so much more to love him before he can love me this much. I need to spend the rest of my life making up for what I've done. I got news for you. Can I confirm something with you? There's nothing you can do, even if you had your lifetime 10 times over, to actually make up for what you've done. So you're thinking, crumbs, is it that bad? Yeah, it's all bad. It's all bad. One little white lie was as bad as the worst thing we could ever think of doing in God's eyes, because he doesn't class it. He doesn't put it on levels. He doesn't score it 1 to 10. Well, you know, you did a number 1 today. It was a 10 yesterday, number 1. No, 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 it's all just sin. It's all just wrong. It's all just in need of his grace. And there's nothing we can do. Not one of us. We're all helpless. When it comes to us doing something enough to make up for what we've done, we are all in the same boat. We cannot do enough. And that's why he sent Jesus to do it for us. Somehow, I know how you're feeling right now, because I've gone through this scenario so many times. Somehow, it doesn't seem right. Isn't it amazing that something so amazing seems so wrong? Like, because human nature is, I've got to do something. I've got to do something. You know, the only thing you can do is accept his grace. Accept the fact that he cannot love you any more or any less than he loves you right now. You could be on your best behavior and he's not going to love you anymore, because he already just loves you as you are. We could put it another way. He hates the sin, but loves the sinner. That puts us all into that same place. He hates the things that we do that can cause us pain and can cause us to have to go through circumstances, but he loves us. Romans 8:38, nothing in all creation can separate us from God's love for us. Nothing we can do in the future. There's no bad that can be so bad that can separate you from God. So I want to ask you a question, whether you're in the building today or whether you're watching online. Same question. You may have accepted Jesus, but do you know that God has accepted you? It's one thing to accept Jesus. In fact, you could be a Christian all your life, having accepted Jesus, but never come to a place of realizing or accepting that God has accepted you. We are accepted and we are acceptable because of his acceptance. Let me say that again. We are accepted and acceptable because of his acceptance. There's nothing we could have done to make ourselves acceptable. There's nothing we can do that could make ourselves acceptable. Jesus had to make us completely acceptable. And all we have to do is accept the acceptance. You think it would be so easy? Like, surely that's easy. Just accept it. It's like, you know, imagine someone saying, all I need on this document to release £10 million to you is your signature. To accept that you accept the money. I don't think that you would really need a lot of encouragement to put your signature on that line, right? And yet what God has given us is worth far more than something like that. In fact, it says in God's word that it's so precious that we can't even put a price on it. We can't even understand the value of it. Maybe that's because, and that's the reason why we find it so hard to accept that God would do something that we can do nothing about. Isn't it just like God to do something that we can do nothing about except accept his grace? So why struggle our whole lives to try and do something, to try and achieve something, and try and put something right that we can't put right, but has already been made put right by just accepting it? That's all we got to do. Oh, but it doesn't seem right. We should have to do more. See, the thing is, we want acceptance more than anything else in life. We want it from our spouses. We want it from our kids. We want it from parents. We want it from peers. We want it from neighbors, co-workers, and the list goes on. Do you know what happens? We buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't even like just to get approval. So many decisions in life are based on this one desire for approval. Often the reason we don't accept acceptance is because we don't feel acceptable to be accepted. Maybe we've been rejected at some point. Maybe because of that we feel disconnected and separated. And then what we do is base that experience, we base what God has done for us on that experience. We start to treat God like we treat the people or the people that have treated us. Well, I had to, you know, I've had to spend a lifetime of making up. Maybe that's what you're still trying to do. Still trying to get your parents' acceptance. That one comment that I often say, you know, in school, you'll amount to nothing. When we were looking for acceptance, we got that. And all our lives, that keeps ringing. Time and time again, that keeps coming back to us. What are we doing? We have to move on and realize that people are foolish with words. And we can't treat God like that because God thinks that we are it. Let's not treat God the same way that we treat others or others treat us. Psychologists say that the way we see ourselves is largely determined by what we think the most important person in our life thinks about us. So let me tell you something today. The most important person in the world thinks that you are totally amazing, totally awesome, and totally acceptable. And he totally approves of you. That should just finish it all. That should just, you know, it doesn't matter what anybody else says about us. You know, I've been through a fair amount of not being accepted and unjustifiably rejected. It's basically the life of a pastor. I know you're thinking, well, I wouldn't do that to you, pastor, and I'm sure you wouldn't. But it's amazing how many people do. And often we don't make a big thing of it. We don't go around telling everybody because that's gossip. Sometimes you can't keep that away because it's public. The rejection is public. The disapproval is public. Now we have more things like Facebook and Twitter and all that stuff. It's more public. But if I was to go on what people think of me, I would not be standing here today. All I can say is I would have been finished a long time ago. And I want to tell you, I am not in this for anything other than just doing it for God, because I've learned I can't do it for people, because I, you know, people like me one minute, then they hate me the next. They, you know, you can be their best friend one minute, and the next minute you're their worst enemy. And you're thinking, I can't keep up with this. It's like a roller coaster. And you just have to come away and go, do you know what? I am not good. It's just like Jesus said, hey, if people hated me, they're going to hate you. And they're going to be up and down like a yo-yo. And he did it for one reason. He went through everything for one reason. Because it was God's will for his life. I will go through this for one reason and one reason only. And there are some Mondays when I have my doubts. But everybody does. It's okay. Don't think your pastors are doubting Thomas. I don't know of one pastor that doesn't deal with some Mondays. When he's thinking, do you know, anything other than doing this job will be great right now. But we do it for one reason, because God's asked us to do it. And so whether people approve or whether people disapprove isn't really the issue. Do you know what? I want to say something that I think really, this could be key to your life today. Do you know what I really believe upsets and grieves the heart of God more than anything else? Like if there was something that we could do to really hurt God, this I think is like top of the list. Let me tell you what it's not. It's not getting life so terribly wrong. It's not making such terrible mistakes or committing such terrible sin. It's not any of those things. Do you know what it is? It's not believing that his grace is enough. Because it's not about the way we live, but refusing to accept the grace to live the way that we live. And we'll never experience future breakthrough if we don't move on from past mistakes. So it's not about what I can do for him. It's all about what he has done for me. We can't make up for what we've done because he's already made up for it through what he did. Our past, our present, and our future. So receiving grace actually depends on placing faith and accepting forgiveness. We got to believe it. We got to accept it. Here's the thing with God. He never sees any differently. He doesn't waver because of the scenario. He always looks through perfect eyes. And when he looks at you, turn to the person next to you and say, he's talking about you right now. He only sees Listen, perfection. You know the best thing you can do today, because the grace of God is unmerited favor. It's a free gift. We can't earn his favor. All we can do is believe it, accept it, and live it.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.